right, everyone. If you are in the back, please find your seat. We're going to get started here in just a second. We'll go ahead and wait for everyone to find a seat. I hope you guys had an awesome SA picnic today. How many freshmen, how many do you think you won today? If you're a freshman, you think you won, raise your hand. Okay, there's not a lot of you raising your hands. All right, you know what? Instead of me going through this, why don't I just invite your SA president up to the stage, and he is going to talk a little bit about what happened today.
Hey guys, hope you guys had a fun time at picnic today. Raise your hand if you got sunburnt today. A lot of people, yeah. Well, we're glad you guys had fun. We're glad that it was a good day. The individual winners of our activities will be announcing tomorrow. I don't want to take up too much time today. We're going to send those out in an email, and you'll be able to come and get your ribbons from us tomorrow. But a lot of y'all wanted to know the overall winning class is, so let's take a look at that. In fourth place with 99 points, we have the freshmen. Good job, freshmen. Coming in at third place with 143 points, we have the sophomores. Good job, sophomores. In first place with 181 points. They won by 19 points. In first place, we have the seniors. Good job, seniors. Juniors came in second with 162 points. Congratulations to our classes. Thank you guys so much for participating. We just want to ask that you contain your excitement and conversation until after week of prayer. We want to be reverent and keep this a reverent place of worship, and we want to be respectful to all the people who come up on stage today and our speaker. So please stay reverent throughout the service. Thank you.
All right. Hey, everybody. I'm excited about Week of Prayer. I love Week of Prayer because each night we get to spend time worshiping and praising God, and I'm so excited about that. I'm thankful that we go to school in a place where that is okay. So tonight, before the praise band plays, as they're coming up, I want to invite our speaker for this week, June Price, to the stage. Let's give Miss June, a welcome, a GCA welcome. Hello, how are you?
Hello, I'm good. It's great to be here. Go freshmen! I love those 99 points! Yeah!
That's right. Half of them clapped, I think. They're like, oh, yeah, we lost. Oh, no, but it was a great week.
If you think about it this way, guys, less than 50 points separated the seniors from the freshmen. They're coming for you. Just watch out.
It's true. Great job, freshmen. Great job, everyone. It was so fun to watch everybody participate today. It was awesome day, beautiful day, seeing everybody, keep those masks on while it was hot out. Ooh. But, you know, such is life. So I just want to say thank you so much for being here with us this week at GCA. Now, you said this was the first time you had been on campus in...
You're trying to give away my age.
That's not what I'm trying to do, but it's been a while, right?
I said in over 30 years. It's been a minute.
It's been a minute.
It looks a lot better now, guys, than it did back then.
It's true. You know, everyone says when you leave the school, like at least when I graduated from GCA, And it seemed like the day that I left, it started improving. And maybe that was because I left. Dr. Gerard is shaking his head yes. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Dr. Gerard, for doing that, agreeing with me. But you know what, before we go any further, I just want to get to know you a little bit. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, where you're currently living, and what you're currently doing in life?
Sure. I am originally from East Tennessee, so I am a Southern girl, so it's good to be back in the South. I'm currently living in Southwest Michigan, which is also a beautiful space, but there's a lot of things that, a lot of like colloquial understandings that we have from the South that I do in the North, and they just look at me like I'm crazy. So it's great to be back in the South.
Like, can you give me an example?
So when I first moved to Michigan, I would be out for a run around campus because I used to work at Andrews University. I used to be a chaplain there. I'd be out around campus just, you know, getting my mile and a half, 2 miles, and I'd be waving at everybody. And everybody look at me like, do I know you? Why is this woman waving? Who's the crazy lady waving at everybody around campus?
So not a lot of waving up there. I experienced that as well when I was in seminary, so we need to just keep waving. You just have to change it. Change
just
that
keep
culture.
Waving.
So, you know, I love food. I really like Taco Bell, and I really like Taco House. But then I got married, and I started to experience the world in much more beautiful ways in terms of cuisine. My wife has opened my, you know, mind to Thai food and all sorts of other things. Tell us a little bit, what is your favorite cuisine? If you could go anywhere to eat, you're not in Calhoun because they probably don't have it in Calhoun, but if you could go anywhere to eat, what kind of cuisine would you choose?
All right, well, let me answer my favorite first. Food. Okay. Just, I love food. Food and I have a love-hate relationship because I love to eat it, and it hates to keep me fit. So if I were going to say, okay, what's my top cuisine, I might have to say Mediterranean. I love Mediterranean.
Mediterranean. Now tell me, what is that? For maybe
Where's
for some
your
listener?
Wife? She needs to get you set straight on this. Mediterranean is so fresh. It's very vegetarian friendly. It has great things like falafel. That's Mediterranean. A great Greek salad. So in that Mediterranean region, lots of fresh herbs and spices and fresh cheese. But it would be followed closely by Italian and Mexican, any Asian. Love all of it. Japanese, Korean. Yeah, I just love food.
Hey, that sounds awesome. Well, yes. Okay, so we talked about food. Let's talk about some things you don't like, okay? Tell us, what is one of your pet peeves? Tell us one of your greatest pet peeves.
One of my greatest pet peeves is elastic waistbands. And I'm going to tell you why, and then you'll understand. I'm the youngest of six siblings, and when I was a kid, it was the funniest thing for my siblings to pants you. If you guys don't know what pants means, do not do this to someone tomorrow on campus. If you wear an elastic waistband, they just come up behind you and drop it straight down. So my pet peeve is elastic waistbands.
Thank you. I got put on in-school suspension once for doing that.
Yeah, it's not a good idea.
It was not a good decision. Don't do that. Okay, so obviously coronavirus has been happening in the world recently, and because of that, you know, we can't travel as much. There's travel restrictions around the world. So let's take a trip down memory lane here. Tell us, what is like your favorite place you've ever traveled to? Like, you know, different country or area of the world?
That is hard as well, but I'm going to say a little town in Italy called Lucca. It's a phenomenal old city. It's the oldest fully walled city with the original walls from centuries and centuries ago. And it's just so quaint, and the food is so phenomenal.
So is that northern, southern?
It's
where is that?
Just outside of Tuscany.
Okay. Yep. Okay. I see Dr. Gerard. By the way, this is our principal, Dr. Gerard, and his wife, Nancy.
Dr.
There.
Gerard, nice to meet you.
They love traveling, it sounds like they've been there before. It seems like they've been there, so that's great. You know, to kind of wrap our time up here, tell me, you know, obviously you're going to share a lot about this week, and so we're going to hear a lot about this, but tell us one thing that you love about Jesus.
Now that's the hardest question to narrow down to one thing. But I will say one thing I love about Jesus, and it's portrayed beautifully in the story of the woman who wipes his feet with her hair and washes his feet with her tears, At the end of what she does for him, he says to Simon, who's judging her the entire time, he says, Simon, who is actually going to love more? The one who's forgiven more or the one who's forgiven little? And Simon says, of course, the one who's forgiven more. And he said, her sins, and they are many, but they have all been forgiven. You've not loved me while I've been in your house, but she's not stopped loving me while I've been in your house. So I just am so grateful as a massive sinner myself for the gracious forgiveness and love of God.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you for that. Is there an appeal? I feel like I should respond to that. That was good. That was good. Well, thank you again for being here, and we're looking forward to this week. And as we begin this week, let's all bow our heads for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you so much again for the opportunity to come together as a school. We've had such an awesome day just spending time together and enjoying activity together. And now, Lord, we're going to finish this day by worshiping together. And I'm so thankful for that. And Lord, I just pray that as we begin this week of prayer, that you would send your spirit upon this place, that our hearts would be open and receptive to your nudging and your leading and your guiding in our lives. And just may we respond to that this week, Lord. Mm-hmm. Whatever it is that's distracting us and whatever it is that's keeping us from drawing closer to you, Lord, please just push that aside and help us to focus on you as we begin this week. I pray for June as she speaks each night. Please anoint her mind and her words as she shares with GCA. And may this be one of those weeks where we look back and we're just like, wow, God showed up during this week of prayer. Mm-hmm. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen. Amen.
Thank you.
The first song that we're going to sing is called Scars. And this song means a lot to me because it talks about how no matter what negative stuff that the world throws at you, God is going to be there through everything. And I think that's something that we can all be thankful for.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Come with expectation, waiting here for you. Waiting here for you. You're the Lord of all creation, and still you know my heart, the author of salvation. You've loved us from the start, waiting here for you, with our hands lifted high in praise, and it's you we adore.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this opportunity for us to come here tonight and spend an hour worshiping you and just thinking about you. Let us keep our eyes on you every day of our lives. We love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks. Thank you, praise team. That was phenomenal. I'm not going to lie. I caught myself singing with you, even though Corona is trying to take that from us. will worship. Even if we have to worship without saying the words out loud, we can definitely say them in our hearts. It was 7 weeks ago, almost to the day, and I was picking up some wood. I was walking along in the lumber yard, and there was wood on a bottom shelf, and there was wood on a top shelf. The top shelf was about 4 feet off the ground, and it had these massive, massive planks of wood. And as I was walking along, I stopped, and I looked at a piece of wood on one section. And I was standing kind of like this, and the piece of wood from the section next to the piece of wood that I was looking at, it was 1 inch thick, it was 12 inches wide, and it was 10 feet tall. That piece of wood fell straight off the shelf and landed on the bridge of my foot. I looked at my foot. I was wearing flip-flops. I looked at my foot, and I said, something is not right. If you see me limping this week, it's not my swagger. It's not my strut. It's the fact that I've been out of a cast for 1 week only. I was working my way through college, and I had to pay the bill, and as you know, private Christian school can be very expensive. And as I knew that I needed money to pay the bill, I decided I was going to take a night job. So I contracted with some local businesses to go in and clean their offices after hours. So all the workers have gone home, but their trash needs emptied, their floors need vacuumed, their desks need dusted, made good money. But it was imperative that I did it quickly, because the quicker I finished an office, the more dollars I made per hour. So I went into this one office. It was a high rise in downtown Chattanooga, because yes, I did go to school at that East Tennessee college not far from here. It was a high rise in downtown Chattanooga, and I went in, and as I went in that night, it was about 7 o'clock, and I noticed out of the corner of my eye that there was one person still there. There are not usually people still there when I went in, but there was, but I was like, I gotta be about my business. I need to clean this. I need to clean it fast so I can make the bank and pay the bills. So I got busy, I dusted, I emptied all the trash, and then it was time to vacuum. Vacuuming was the thing I would do last before I would leave. So I had done every office except for the head honcho's office. And when I went into his office with the vacuum, it looked like a hurricane had gone off in his floor. I think he had taken his hole punch to punch holes in papers that day, and every time he emptied it, he just emptied it not in the trash can, but all over the floor. So I had vacuumed the main parts of the floor, the big parts of the floor, where it was easy for the vacuum to get these tiny little paper punches. But there was this part of the desk that way back up under the desk, there was still this one hole punch of paper. I wanted to do a good job because I wanted to get a raise. I wanted to secure the job. So I tried to push the vacuum under there. I tried to get it all the way, but the vacuum was not picking up that piece of paper. By this time, I'm like, this paper is my arch nemesis. But I knew the paper had to come out. So I said, well, I'm just going to, because in the sake of time, I'm just going to hold the vacuum in this one hand, and I'm just going to just reach. I'm going to reach all the way up under there and get that from the floor. And I did. I had it in my hands, and immediately the vacuum sucked up my hair. My hair was longer than it is now, so I have to tell you, friends, it was painful. I had now my hair completely sucked up to the vacuum. I'm on the ground, and it's beginning to stink. If you've ever smelled burning hair, it is not a nice aroma. So now here I am, my vacuum is literally sucking up my face, and I can't reach the handle to turn it off because it's all the way at the top, and I can't get the plug to unplug it, so I'm just here in the office, and that one lonely guy comes by, and the look on his face, something is not right. I was 14. I was in between my freshman year of high school and my sophomore year of high school. And my job on Fridays was to mow the grass. And when I say the grass, that's kind of like a real misnomer, because I lived on a farm in East Tennessee. We had acres and acres and acres of land. So this was mowing all around the fences. It was mowing all through the orchard. It was mowing, yes, the front yard and the backyard. And in the country, you got a side yard on both sides. Just a lot of wild farmland. But we had this old club cadet. And this old club cadet did not cooperate. It took at least 15 to 20 minutes to get it started. I'm not exaggerating for effect here. It literally took that long to get it started every time you wanted to mow the yard. yard. You got to kind of kick it this way and bounce on it that way and flex this and hit the battery, all kinds of stuff to get this stupid mower started. So by the time I finally got it started, I knew that I wanted to mow as much as possible before the mower stopped. So I had been mowing for a good hour and a half to 2 hours, and I thought to myself in my 14-year-old mind, this mower is going to run out of gas. But I don't want to have to go through that 15 to 20 minutes of trying to start this mower again if I turn it off. So I decided, with all the wisdom that I had in all those years of my life, just to leave the mower on. I'll just fill it up with gas while it's running. And back then, and it was a minute ago, you know, it was 30 years ago when I was at GCA. It was a minute ago. So you could get off the mower and it would stay running. So I got off the mower. It was the kind where on the big hood, that's where the gas tank was. I had the gas can in my hand with all the boldness that I knew I could do this. I just untightened the top of that gas valve. And no sooner had I taken the lid off, whoosh, fire everywhere. And I was leaning over it with a gas can in my hand. So guess what? The fire set me on fire. My hair was flaming. My body was burning. And you do not think stop, drop, and roll when you're on fire. I promise you that. If any of you ever been on fire, you can confirm it for me. I did not think stop, drop, and roll. So I'm just running now. I'm flailing around like a wild woman. I still have the gas can in my hand. Probably by the grace of the Holy Spirit alone did I drop the gas can. I'm still running, and thank God, I actually ran into our doghouse. And our doghouse was sitting on a piece of land that's actually very close to the place where the washing machine lets out its water from the house. So it was kind of muddy there. So when I ran into the doghouse, it actually knocked me backwards into the mud. And when the fire finally was out, I just looked at myself. I was in pain from head to toe. And I said, something is not right. I said, I got to go inside. I got to get some cold water. I have to find some relief somewhere. So I went to the door that I promise you, not one day before that day, and probably not one day since that day, has ever been locked. It was a sliding glass door on the back of the house. My sister next to me, her name is April. I told you already I'm the youngest of six. My parents were tired of naming children. So I was born in June, thus June. She was born in April, thus April. My sister April's job on Friday afternoon was to clean the house. She had locked the sliding glass door because she was mopping, and she didn't want me to come inside and step on her clean floor. So I'm pounding on the sliding glass door. April, let me in. I've been on fire. April, let me in. I've been on fire. She comes to the door. She looks me up. She looks me down. And that same look is on her face. Something is not right. More recently than I want to tell you, I don't want to tell you, but I know some of you are going to resonate with this one. More recently than I'm going to say, I was out shopping, and I drank a lot of water on that day. And what goes in, friends, must come out. So I'm out shopping, and I'm just like, I have got to find a bathroom. You know when you do that little special walk? Try to play it cool. I've got to find a bathroom. This is imperative. So I'm just walking along through the mall, and oh, there's a bathroom. I was so happy I made a beeline. I went straight through. I went straight in. I opened the thing. I sat on the stall, and whew, I'm telling you what, I was feeling good then. But then, some very heavy-footed traffic began to enter my ear canal. And I said, I don't usually remember hearing that prominent of foot traffic when I'm sitting in the stall in the bathroom. And the feet came right up to the stall where I was, and I thought they would continue on to another stall, but they kind of stopped right in front of my stall. But instead of turning toward the stalls, they turned away from the stalls. And then I heard what I can only describe as what Niagara Falls must sound like. It was a rushing, rushing, rushing sound of water. I said, that is a lot of liquid, and that is not a female. Something was not right. Pray with me. God, today we need you to show us that something is not right. We need you, Father, to show us where we're believing wrong things, where we're portraying wrong things. And God, through your holy and high touch, change us into people that look like you, that walk like you, that talk like you, that smell like you, Father. Get all the glory that you deserve out of us. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Friends, I want to just introduce you to our theme for this week. You see it all over the place. Those who are involved in decorating this stage, thank you so much. It is beautiful. I am a canvas. I am a canvas. And the reason I'm a canvas, friends, is so that I can invite God, the creator of the world and the universe, to take my life and paint a portrait of himself upon it, to show a watching world what he's really, really like. But here's a fear that I have when it comes to my life being a canvas. This is what often happens when I'm the canvas. I get busy painting a portrait, and the world gets busy watching, but that portrait, more often than not, just looks like June. Doesn't look anything like Jesus. Let me put some freckles here. Add in some of my attributes, not necessarily God's attributes. Let me put some curly red hair on here. When my life is a canvas and I do not let God demonstrate and show through me who he is, then I end up showing a world a picture of God in which something is not right. And this is why we desperately need God to come down and do what only he can do in our life. I want to tell you a very simple but profound truth. Behavior is the child of belief. Belief is the parent of behavior. It's absolutely true, not only in science and psychology, but we see it in the Bible as well. I want to show you just from the stories I told you. I believed that I could reach that piece of paper and do it quickly without a complication, so I reached underneath the desk to get the piece of paper. I believed it, my behavior followed. I believed that I could put gas in the lawnmower without complication. I believed it, therefore my behavior followed, and I did it. I believed that it was the women's restroom. I wouldn't have run in and made myself so comfortable in stall number one if I thought it was the men's restroom. But I believed it, and my behavior followed. Chidi believes he can drive a car, which is why he keeps driving, and he keeps wrecking. If you don't know about his most recent incident, make sure you talk to him this afternoon. Friends, our behavior is the child of our belief. The Bible is full of these examples as well. Abraham had a fine wife. The Bible lets us know in Genesis chapter 20, Abraham married to Sarah, who obviously was the most stunning woman, because he believed that if he took his fine wife into this particular kingdom where King Abimelech was king, then certainly what would happen is the king would look at her and say, "Man, I want her for my own. Is this your husband? Because he's got to go." And he would end up killing Abraham. That's what Abraham believed. And since Abraham believed it, he chose to behave by lying and saying, "Hey, this is my sister." Behavior is the product of our belief. Elijah, in 1 Kings 19, Elijah, after having a massive victory at Mount Carmel, God sending down fire from heaven and defeating Baal and all those who followed Baal, Elijah, now believing in fear that Jezebel is surely going to kill me, Elijah behaves by running into the desert and hiding. Peter, in Galatians, it says very clearly in chapter 2 that Peter, who had been eating with Gentiles and enjoying his time eating at the table of Gentiles, saw some Jews were watching him and decided, "Well, I believe that the Jews would not approve of me eating with Gentiles." So his behavior changed and he stopped eating with the Gentiles. And Paul, in the same chapter of Galatians 2, rebuked Peter. He said, "I believe you're being a hypocrite, and because I believe you're being a hypocrite, I'll rebuke you." Behavior is the child of belief. I want to tell you this, and I want to ingrain it so deeply into you, friends, because I need you to recognize that much of the inaccurate picture we're painting of God comes from a faulty belief that we ourselves have about who God is. Because guess what? The world watches and decides, oh, that's what God looks like, Christian? Christian, that's what God looks like? You said you're a Christian, and I'm going to watch your life. And when I watch your life, I'm going to assume that that's who God is. And that's why God, friends, has got such a bad rep among so many people, some of you in this very room included. At times in my life, a bad rep for me too. Because we believe things about God that are not true beliefs. And out of those beliefs, we practice behaviors and we attribute our dysfunction. Attribulate's not a word. Come on, somebody in English, don't cut me slack on that. Attribulate, please. We attribute our own dysfunction to God, and we call it holiness. That's not what God is about. I want to just take a few brief moments as I'm closing. I'm going to keep it brief because the Word of God can act mightily and powerfully without a lot of labor. I want to just take a few minutes and give you one very true biblical example that will help you begin to unpack how what we believe about God shapes what we do, and how what we do actually paints a portrait of a watching world about who God is that so many times is inaccurate. We're going to look at the life of Job. If you haven't heard about Job, it is the earliest recorded book in all of Scripture. And I think it's fascinating that the first written book in Scripture happens to be this book that deals with the portrait of God saying, God, are you responsible for pain? God, are you responsible for suffering? God, do you bring evil and destruction on people's lives? That's the first book that was recorded. So let me just give you a brief synopsis, and then we're going to read a few texts that help us understand what Job himself believed and what his friends believed about this God that they served. Job, it says, was a righteous man. And Job, all of a sudden, it appeared to him out of nowhere, just wreaked devastation, trauma, left, right, and sideways. He lost his livestock. He lost his employees. He lost his children. He lost his grandchildren. Then he lost his health. And he's sitting just scratching naked in the middle of the wilderness, miserable. But I want to tell you that four of Job's friends wanted to come and console him. They wanted to console him by holding up a picture of who God was to try to help him out in this time. But the picture that Job's friends held up, and in fact the picture that Job himself held up, was an inaccurate picture of who God is. Job and his friends all agreed on this same simple belief. If you experience tragedy, if you experience pain, suffering, and loss, it is God punishing you as a result of your sins. All five of them believed the same thing. The only difference was Job said, I contest, I protest, because I haven't sinned. I believe what you believe. If I had sinned, I would say, God, I deserve the punishment. God, go ahead, bring suffering, bring pain, bring destruction, because that's who I believe you to be, God. But wait a minute, I have not sinned. I want to take a look in Scripture real quick because you need to be in Scripture. Don't just trust it because I said it, guys. Be in Scripture for yourself. I want to take a look at a few verses in Job that will help you see this belief about God presented. And we're going to look a couple places throughout the chapter just so you see it's a consistent belief. First, we're going to look at Job 5:17, and this is what Job's friends say. It says, consider the joy of those who are corrected by God. Do not despise the discipline of the Almighty when you sin. Job 32:2, this is Job's friends again saying, and they were angry at him because Job refused to admit that he had sinned and that God was punishing him. And then in Job 6:29, Job says, stop assuming my guilt. I have done no wrong. And in Job 19:21 to 22, Job says, have mercy on me, my friends, for the hand of God has struck me. Must you also persecute me like God is persecuting me? I want to tell you, friends, that when Job was under that amount of tragedy and he looked to his belief about God to bring him comfort, it only brought him confusion because he believed, just like his friends, that God is the originator of pain, of suffering, and it's a punishment for my sin. Ellen G. White says clearly in Desire of Ages that the author, the originator of sin, evil, and all of its consequences is the devil, period. The results of sin, the pain, the destruction, the chaos, the author of that is the devil. It is not God. But we've done a vital disservice to the image of God by believing something very similar to what Job and his friends believed. But I want to encourage you today, like the story of Job encouraged me, please do not settle with your beliefs. Job said persistently over and over again throughout the whole book, listen, I got to take my case to God myself. I got to talk to God. Look, friends, you're trying to comfort me, but you're no comfort to me. I will not rest until I have an audience with the Creator. I've got to talk to Him. Your only true north, your only standard that can be trusted come thick or thin is God and what God says. So I want to be like Job, and I want you to be like Job. And when you find yourself seeing God one way, please be humble enough to say, God, I got to talk to you because it's not making sense. And when Job talked to God in those final chapters, you'll see how God, as he answers, challenges the very core of what Job and his four friends believed. How he challenges what they thought arrogantly about what they knew about God. And what they were teaching a watching world about God. I'm going to invite the musicians to come forward as I close today. We're going to this week spend a lot of time in the Word of God. I hope you bring your Bibles. On your phones is fine with me if you're allowed to do that. If not, then bring the hard copy. It's great too. But I want you to begin to realize the depth of the truth in God's Word. We're going to look through Scripture and we're going to see how in our humanness we have attributed beliefs about God to God that are not representative of who God is. And how in doing so, we've painted a portrait of God that is not accurate. And ask God together, Father, please paint a portrait on my life, on this canvas, on that canvas, on that canvas. Please paint a portrait on us of who you really are. Because we're desperate for you. Friends, we say things in our prayers like, God, if it be your will, heal Susie's mother of cancer. Don't let her die. Friends, it's always God's will for life. It says it very clearly throughout Scripture. You see it in 2 Peter and 1 Timothy. It's not his will that anyone would perish. We say things like, I didn't study for that test at all, but woo, God gave me an A. And your friend who studied and prayed is sitting right next to you in the cafeteria table, and God didn't give them an A? The crazy things that we attribute to God and do damage to his character because of our belief system that's unsurrendered to a Father who is passionately, desperately, and wildly in love with the just and the unjust alike. Matthew 5 says, I send sunshine and rain on both. So tonight as I pray, I ask that you would join this week with me really saying, God, come on up in my address, not only in my mailbox, not only in my neighborhood, come into my living room and rearrange some things because I don't want to be a canvas that's just flesh on parade. Nobody needs to see June, but all of us desperately need to see Jesus. God, thank you. Thank you, Father. Be glorified. In your name I pray. Amen.
Josh is going to say something.
As Julia was going to say, thank you so much for coming out tonight. We're going to dismiss in the same way that we dismiss from church tonight. So we're going to dismiss from the back row as we did last Sabbath, and the supervision team, if you guys wouldn't mind dismissing, starting with the back row. Thank you guys so much for coming out, and we hope to see you tomorrow evening for our second night beginning at 7 p.m. Thank you very much.